O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. In the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts, be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace be yours this day from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. The text for this morning's meditation comes to us from our gospel lesson in Luke chapter 7. You know, being a father, you have to make some sacrifices, and one of those things, of course, is the television programming that you have to watch. And as I've watched my share of Elmo, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and Power Rangers and all that good stuff, I can't help but say I noticed a theme that has kind of progressed from even the younger years for the children and even as they get a little older. That understanding of the importance of not forgetting who you are. Don't forget who you are. From the early lessons of Elmo, it's don't forget your name. Don't forget who your parents are so you don't talk to strangers, right? Don't forget who you are. And as they get a little older, they hear that same message. Don't forget who you are, meaning don't forget where you've come from, how hard you've practiced. Don't give up. Don't forget you come from a long line of rich heritage. Grasp onto that. Don't forget who you are. Now, of course, we as parents, godly parents, whether it be actual biological parents or just fatherly or motherly figures, we understand and we hope that our children and the people under our care will carry that out with them. Don't forget who you are. Don't forget the values that you've been taught. Don't forget who you are in Jesus Christ. Don't forget to worship on Sunday mornings. Don't forget those great principles that you've been taught. Carry them on with you. Don't forget who you are. When we meet and greet one another, we say our name and tell a little bit about who we are. Now, what do we usually tell? The positives, right? I do this for a living, maybe some of the things that we've accomplished. But what's a real part of who we are, maybe some of those negative things that have taken place. They've helped shape us, right? Maybe some of the times that we failed. But we don't go up and say, hi, I'm a failure. Sometimes that we've made mistakes or maybe lost. We've lost in a game or two. Hi, I'm a loser. But we don't go in and say things like that, right? Because we don't want those things to identify who we are. But at the same time, they do in some sense, don't they? Or at the very least, society might have a way of bringing some of those things from your past and placing them on you so that you are identified or labeled in this way. And certainly that's what we find with this woman who's in our gospel for today. She is one who is of the city. She is one who is labeled a sinner, one who doesn't do the work or the will of God. Before we talk about her, I'd like to talk for a second about Jesus. Who is Jesus? Remember, that's Luke's goal all along, to uncover who Jesus is, so that people know who he is. He is the Messiah, the one who has come to proclaim peace to those who are captive, to do the wonderful, marvelous works of God for all the people to see. That's who Jesus is. But who does Simon, this Pharisee, think Jesus is? That's the question. And the reality is, we can find the answer to that question from his perspective by the way that he welcomes Jesus into his house. He doesn't give him a royal welcome. He doesn't treat him to a great feast where he is the guest of honor. Instead, he treats him more like a colleague. He doesn't welcome him in to wash his feet. He doesn't give him a kiss on the cheek, a humble welcome. He doesn't put oil on his head. He doesn't waste any of that on Jesus. He welcomes him in as one who might be an equal. Why? Because he hears about this Jesus. He hears of the things that he has done. And most certainly now he wants to hear about what he says. He wants to hear the teachings, what he's proclaiming. Welcomes him in as an equal because he himself, a Pharisee, is high up there. He is high on the pedestal. But what he can't imagine or fathom is why this Jesus, the one who is supposedly a prophet, one who may be like the Messiah, is here now allowing for this woman to touch him. For he should know what this woman is like. He should know what she has done. Now, the scripture doesn't give us an understanding of what she is or what she's done. Maybe she's a harlot, a prostitute. Maybe she's a thief, one who's committed murder. We don't know any of that. The important thing, at least from the Pharisee's perspective, is that she is a sinner. That's who she is. The Pharisee is the Pharisee, and Jesus as well. We haven't quite figured that out yet. But it doesn't make sense for him to allow for her to touch him. Now, why is that? Why is he so wrapped up in all of this? Well, I think it's pretty easy for us to understand and get behind this because we have a way of comparing one another, don't we? I won't say I'm perfect, but that person is doing things they shouldn't be doing. We love those comparative statements, don't we? Better than, greater than, lesser than, closer to, further away from. We like to have that measure of comparison so that we can find where we fit in, or at the very least, place ourselves in a situation where we might look better than others. See, this Pharisee put himself in too favorable of a comparison. For his understanding is he deserves to be in Jesus' presence, at least a little bit more than she does. That's a terrible way to look at that situation. As if perfection, sure, is not something we can attain to, but at least it's something that can't be ignored. It's like sitting first class on an airplane that's going down. Or sitting in the best spot on a yacht that's about ready to sink. It doesn't truly matter where you are or how good you think you look in the process. You are all sinners. And I most certainly am included. We have to take all sin seriously. And of course, we have to understand that the sinfulness is a dirty mess. We get involved with sin. You're going to have dirt on you. And I think the Pharisees have this picture. Because they don't want this woman anywhere near them. They want to push her away. They want to get as far away from her as possible. She shouldn't even be in the house because she's making his house unclean. She wants her to make this Pharisee unclean. They want her as far away as possible. But what they don't realize is that they themselves are steeped in just as much sin as she is. You know, we have this Old Testament lesson of David committing this heinous crime, of having adultery and then sitting right at his height into the front of the line so that he dies and not even take Bathsheba for his wife. Upon hearing all of this, David says, or Nathan says to David, you know what? You're not going to die, you confess, but your son will die. So we have the wonderful confession of Psalm 51, where David pleads with God and says, I am a sinner. I'm a sinner from the time my mother conceived. Don't you and I confess the same thing? Who are you? Who are we? We're all prideful, seeking our own interests. We all are in debt. Jesus gives us a parable. Some owe 50 denarii, some owe 500, or a better way of putting it, some owe 3 years of their salary's worth. Others owe 2 or 3 months. But regardless, it's a debt you can't pay off. That's who we are. And this woman knew that. And that's why she falls at Jesus' feet. She knows exactly what her identity is on her own. She knows she is a woman of the city. She knows she is a sinner, sinful at first, but she knows who Jesus is. And that's why she weeps.
That's why she mourns. That's why she has the only thing she has with her in her possessions, her hair, her tears, and the flowing bottle of perfume, and starts to pour it on Jesus. Because whatever she has, she's going to use it to glorify God. Because she knows that there's something great, there's something special about this Jesus who is for her and for sinners like her. As we read this story, we can't help but also have Nathan pointing his finger at us, saying, you are the man, you are the woman, you are the one steeped in sin at birth as well. And we cry out to the Lord saying, yes, we know our identity, we are sinners. But at the same time, we weep with joy, because we know who we are in Jesus. We know that Jesus is God in the flesh. He comes down not to cast all of his wrath upon us. He comes down not as the Lord of hosts with all of his angels to smite us. He comes not to punish us for all of our sins, but he comes down with hands and feet and eyes and ears. He comes in the flesh to die for us. Not to execute us, but to take on an execution. Instead of an exile being cast out of the city, we are welcomed into his eternal presence. Instead of being called people of the city, we are people of the city of God. Instead of being cast out into the weeping and gnashing of teeth, we are welcomed in to his eternal presence where he loves us so dearly. The debt has been erased forever. What's amazing is what happens next. Jesus actually looks and declares to the woman, your sins, all of them, no matter how great they are, they have been forgiven. Go. While all the others around the table are debating who Jesus is, she goes. While all the other individuals are questioning how he can forgive sins, she goes. And that's what you and I are called to do today. To go. To leave this place with all of our sins forgiven. To continue to proclaim the word and the kingdom of God that has no end. Because who are we? We are in Christ. Who are we? We are children of the Heavenly Father. Who are we? We are forgiven people. Who are we? We are a royal priesthood. Who are we? We are people chosen from the beginning of time for the works of God. Who are we? We are children of the Heavenly Father, redeemed for a specific purpose. Who are we? Winners. Conquerors in Christ. So today and every day, we weep in repentance and we weep with joy. For while our sin is great, God's love and mercy is greater still. Amen.
Amen.
May the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep our hearts and minds in our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's not